Hi, I'm Mark Hughes. My guest today is Madeleine Hammerlund, housing campaign organizer for Our Future Starts at Home. She has an initiative going before the House and Senate on housing for Minnesotans, especially the disabled, whereby they'll use a tax to be proposed.
My guest today is Tom Pearson, president of Market Research, and we've got he's fantastic because he's going to be talking about the One Minnesota survey that the Governor's Council on Developmental Disabilities had just conducted, and fantastic information about people with disabilities being discriminated against.
And so it should be a real interesting, action-packed half hour. We hope you'll stay tuned because Disability Viewpoints is next. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. With me is Madeleine Hammerlund, and she's the housing campaign organizer for Our Future Starts at Home, and she's going to tell us a little bit about that. She has an interesting project coming up in the House and Senate, so she's got a lot to say, and we'll let her begin right now. Go ahead,
Madeleine. Yeah, absolutely. Well, Mark, thank you so much for inviting the Our Future Starts at Home Coalition to share about our work. You know, we are a group of Minnesotans, housing advocates, and organizations that believe Minnesotans, no matter what we look like or where we come from, we belong in safe and healthy homes that we can afford. And so we're making a bold proposal this year that includes the Minnesota Constitutional Amendment for Housing to make sure that we have long-term statewide housing support and investments.
Right. So who and what is the Our Future Starts at Home coalition? What groups are involved there?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, our leading principles include race equity, accessibility, climate resilience and sustainability, uplifting rural voices, and making sure that those who are most impacted by our housing crisis are our leaders. And so we have organizations including the ARC of Minnesota, American Indian Community Housing and Housing Organization, including interfaith organizations like MICA.
Right.
And these are strong advocates for housing, but also we know that we have interfaith organizations and beyond who are working to make changes across our state.
Right. That sounds like a great idea. What is the Minnesota Constitutional Amendment for Housing?
Yeah, absolutely. This is a question that I get all the time. It's really similar to an amendment that was actually passed in 2008, the Legacy Amendment. And it was also a proposal of a sales tax of 3/8 of 1%. Mm-hmm. Instead of supporting arts, parks, and natural spaces, we know that we need dedicated, ongoing housing support and investments. And so it's a proposal of 3/8 of 1%. And what does that look like over a year? That's $400 million to $440 million every year. But 3/8 of 1%, what does it look like in a Minnesotan's pocket? Well, I'll tell you, every time we spend $100 on sales tax items, that looks like 37 cents going to neighbors and family to make sure they have what they need mm-hmm. so that they can stay housed. One of the things we recognize is that there are a lot of housing approaches that need to be supportive. When we think about who owns property here in Minnesota, we can recognize that white Minnesotans own more homes than any other community, and that's leaving communities out and behind. And so it's a proposal to eliminate racial disparities in home ownership and make sure that preventative services are supportive. We know prevention is the most fiscally and financially best approach to make sure housing instability does not occur in our state. So making sure that shelters, emergency rental assistance, housing vouchers are made available. And of course, we know Minnesotans need places to live. So that's building accessible, climate resilient, and sustainable, affordable units throughout our state.
Great.
Yeah, absolutely.
What kind of activities and events has the coalition supported in 2023, and what can we expect in 2024?
Yeah, 2023 was a really fun year. It was all about building coalition members and bringing in Minnesotans to our work. So a lot of it was having intimate conversations about what is needed throughout our state. I was really fortunate. I visited Duluth, Rochester, Moorhead, St. Cloud.
You've traveled.
Yes. Yeah, the coalition really wants to realize this amendment in our state, but also visiting county fairs, prides in the parks, mm-hmm. connecting with people who are experiencing housing crisis, collecting stories, learning why others would support dedicated funding like this. One of the other reasons we've been really focused on building support, resources, and relationships is because we need 72 Minnesotans to be ready to guide those funds once they are appropriated. That means individuals who are disability advocates, tribal and indigenous voices, union representatives. We need people with lived experience with homelessness to not just be generating these funds, but to be reshaping our housing system.
And then why is the coalition proposing a Minnesota constitutional amendment for housing? And also, I want to ask a question. When you travel throughout the state,
yeah.
there are people that you make friends with.
Of course.
And they stay in touch with you, and they want to do more.
Yes.
And that's going to be uplifting, too.
Yeah. No, it is incredibly powerful to hear how motivated people are to change Minnesota for the better, mm-hmm. to make sure that we're getting out there and voting our values. It's incredibly powerful. It's a big opportunity.
Right. And what strategy are you using to improve the likelihood of passing the Minnesota Constitutional Amendment for Housing in the House and Senate?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're using a couple different strategies. The one that I'm most excited about right now is the project called the Housing Narrative Change Project. One of the things we know is that language shapes our culture, and our culture shapes our values. So there's a wide project going on throughout the state where we are learning the most powerful and impactful language that we can use with one another,
right.
with lawmakers and our neighbors, to make sure that our values and our language are aligned. And when we start to make that cultural change, we have opportunities for not just big housing wins like the Minnesota Constitutional Amendment for Housing, but even those beyond. Of course, other strategies like I shared, tabling, connecting with Minnesotans, but also we know we need to be at the Capitol. How do we help our...
Yes, you do.
Yes, we do. How do we help our lawmakers not just become listening, but become strong partners and champions of housing as a priority for 2024 and beyond?
How can Minnesota Advocates, leaders, and all of our statewide neighbors get involved? How can we help you today?
Yeah, well, thank you so much for asking. One of the best ways is actually to connect over our website. Please visit ourhomesmn.org.
One more time.
Yeah, absolutely. Ourhomesmn.org.
Great.
Or you can reach out to me, and my name's quite long, but it's Madeleine Hammerlund, Madeleine.Hammerlund@MHPonline.org.
There you go. Do that one more time.
Absolutely. Madeleine.Hammerlund@MHPonline.org.
Okay, we come to the part of the show where I do the final word segment. Is there anything that we should have covered we may have missed that you want to enlighten us with in the couple minutes we have left?
Yeah, absolutely. As I shared, one of our principles is accessibility. Mm-hmm. And that means that we need disability advocates, storytellers, and the true things that are occurring that are creating barriers to housing, and also our housing dreams. Those are the things that are going to motivate us, shape our housing system. And so the opportunity to connect with disability viewpoints in your community is really powerful. So thank you for this opportunity.
Well, thank you for coming in. It was great. Anything else you want to add, or you think we're good? You want to save it for when you come back for part two?
Part two.
Oh.
Let me think.
I got some time left, so if there's another subject you want to cover, go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think what I'd like to raise up is that in the upcoming session, 2024, we are doing some work at the Capitol where if there are individuals who are curious about doing testimony, who are interested in attending a rally we have coming up on February 20th, of this year, that would be incredibly powerful. Join us at the Capitol for a rally around housing. Bring your story, bring your power, and bring your people.
How did you get started in this?
Yeah, well, I'm incredibly fortunate. I've been organizing within education and public health previously here in Minnesota, and including door knocking. And let me say, mm-hmm. I just love Minnesota families.
You're ready for politics.
I don't know about that. But I'm definitely ready to make Minnesota the best place to raise a child and build a family. And we know that housing is going to be critical to our future education outcomes, our healthcare outcomes, and our employment opportunities.
It is. It's a bigger issue than I think you realize, because we have to help everybody in housing at every income level, and that's not always easy to do. But we need to do that, because you've got to have a place to hang your hat.
And we need resources for that. And one of our biggest, most powerful resources right now is funding.
Right.
And when we pass this, we have an opportunity to bring those resources forward to make sure that all Minnesotans have access to safe, healthy homes, no matter their zip code, mm-hmm. no matter their income, that they can afford.
Right. So after session is done, what do you do then to keep advocating?
I hit the road. I am out there. I'm going to get out and visit at different county fairs. Mm-hmm. If there is a location, an event that you think that myself or others from the Our Future Starts at Home Coalition should be at, please get in touch with us. Those are opportunities that we don't want to miss.
So how do you raise your funds?
Yeah, absolutely. So right now we're moving through grants, but we also welcome private donations. You know, mm-hmm. someone who would be willing to provide something as little as $5 right. would be so appreciated. We know that, again, funding is one of our powerful resources, just like our networks. And so if it's not funds that you can provide, who should mm-hmm. we be speaking with, and how can we best get in touch with them?
So from your first day of doing this, is this everything you expected, more? It's got to be pretty rewarding.
You know, one of the things I love the truth and I love stories. Mm-hmm. And so much of my work is collecting both. True mm-hmm. stories of Minnesotans, what they need, what their dreams are, who they want to be in the world. And I know that where we live and who we are surrounded right. by in our community helps shape that. And it should be positive.
Well, I think what you should, can I recommend? What you should do is call the libraries in the Twin Cities here.
That's a great idea.
And see if you can become a guest speaker. I know they used to do it in Minneapolis, and I can check at a library that I know of if you have a card when we're done, and I'll see about doing that. And then they usually do night or day things. You have to call and schedule the time, but that might be a good thing to do, because then you'll know every neighborhood and every community.
That's really thoughtful. I think that one of the powerful things about library mm-hmm. is our public spaces.
Right.
And so they're incredibly accessible and welcoming. That's definitely a network that we should be connecting with. Thank you for that.
And you're not afraid to step up to the podium. I can see that.
Well, when I have a chance to share, I do my best to bring everyone with me.
So if you had a chance to do this all over again, what would you change? What do you think is working? What do you think could be improved? What do you think could be done different?
Yeah, one of the things that I reflect on often is that if we really want to win, we need all of us. It doesn't matter our skin color, it doesn't matter our language. We all need to become messengers for about the power of housing and safe, healthy homes. And so what I want to do is make sure that we all feel comfortable, supported, and powerful
That's
when we
a big
talk
word.
About housing advocacy.
That's a big word. So how do you feel comfortable with it? When you go home at 5 o'clock every night, how do you close your day timer and say, I'm comfortable with what I did today? How do you get comfortable with that?
I'll share with you. That's actually that's pretty tricky. I like to work.
Yeah, I know. I do too. I don't know. I was home at 5 o'clock either.
No. I think one of the things that really prepares me for my day is I like to, in the morning, get centered in what I'm trying to do. I want to make the world more equitable, more peaceful, more liberated, more just. And I believe that this campaign is going to realize those things.
Oh, yeah, and that everybody should be heard.
Absolutely.
At any level.
Yes, we should all be welcome.
I want to thank you for being on here, and we put a lot of information out in about the last few minutes, and I hope the people at home will take heed, and if you want to help out, we've given the website, and we hope you enjoy it. Join Madeleine in her quest. And so thanks for watching, everybody. We'll see you next time on Disability Viewpoints.
In January 2019, Governor Tim Walz signed an executive order creating the One Minnesota Council on Diversity, Inclusion, and Equity. A multi-phase intersectionality study was conducted and focused on the intersectionality of racial inequity in communities, and it also included developmental disabilities that leads in social discrimination and disparities across delivery systems and program areas. With me today to discuss this survey is Tom Pearson. Tom, welcome.
Thank you, Joan.
Now, Tom, you're with your own individual company called Market International?
Market Response International.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So you own your company and you do all these surveys with your team.
Myself and my team, we've had the honor and pleasure of doing research projects for the Governor's Council on Developmental Disabilities since the year 2000. So we're in our 24th year, actually.
Okay, well, let's talk about this study, this survey here. How did it come about? And let's just slowly get into the findings because it was absolutely fascinating reading it.
Great. Well, I have some slides to show, and we'll start from where it started, and that is mm-hmm. with the One Minnesota Promise. And as you said, that was in 2019.
Sure.
Governor Walz signed the executive order. And the statement, as it's shown here, is disparities in Minnesota, including those based on race, geography, and economic status, keep our entire state from reaching its full potential.
Mm-hmm.
As long as these inequities impact Minnesotans' ability to be successful, we've got more work to do, he said. The problem was he didn't say anything about people with disabilities.
Right.
And so the Minnesota Governor's Council on Developmental Disabilities engaged us to do research back then in 2019.
Mm-hmm.
And we did interviews with a range of people with disabilities to get their input, ideas, and opinions of what it would take for them to be included in the One Minnesota Promise.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a slide from that showing a Senator Durenberger with a self-advocate with developmental disabilities. Anyway, then flash forward, achieving the One Minnesota mm-hmm. Promise is actually synonymous with eliminating discriminatory behaviors and barriers that limit the possibility of people to achieve their full potential. It's about discrimination
mm-hmm. Right.
in the end. And so last year, or 2022, we did the first exploratory study on the concept of intersectionality.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the intersection of people who have disabilities with being also part of some other marginalized community. So we wanted to understand the nature of discrimination, all its mm-hmm. forms, how it is experienced by various groups with intersecting profiles, and what the impacts are, short and long term. And so that study in 2022 involved us reading a lot of different articles that have been published on the subject of discrimination and mm-hmm. intersectionality and so forth. And we also did narrative research, qualitative research, where we heard stories from a lot of people with disabilities on their experiences with barriers that they encounter and other experiences where they're not treated
sure.
as well as other people are treated. So then we used the findings from that research to inform the design of a survey, a questionnaire that we could go out and use to measure how are we doing? How are we doing in achieving the One Minnesota Promise for everyone, including people with disabilities. And the whole idea behind that is that we can use that survey over time mm-hmm. to measure our progress.
Sure, that makes sense.
So we do a baseline study that we completed in September of last year, and then maybe in 5 years we repeat the study, right? See
right.
if we've moved the needle. And so the primary measures, one of the primary measures comes from these three questions in the survey. And they are, within the past 12 months, do you believe you were unfairly treated, worse than how others are treated? Mm-hmm. within the past 12 months, do you believe you encountered barriers or obstacles to needed products or services? And do you believe you were restricted from opportunities, privileges, or activities? So these were all separate questions, mm-hmm. Yes or no, respondents answered yes or no to these three questions.
Okay.
And so what we did is we combined those, the percents of yeses to measure the discrimination incidences of mm-hmm. different groups. And so we divided our sample into four groups, white people without a disability,
mm-hmm.
BIPOC folks without a disability, BIPOC meaning Black, Indigenous, people of color,
okay.
White with disability, and BIPOC with a disability. And so—
So that's four different groups.
Four different groups, that's right. And so we wanted to measure the incidences of discrimination experiences with each group. And so what we're showing here to begin with at the top is white without disability, the index of the occurrences of these kinds of negative experiences mm-hmm. was 33.
Hmm.
And that's not a percent, it's an index based on the number of times someone mm-hmm. said yes to one of these among that group. So that's white people without a disability, right? So that's kind of the benchmark that we will okay. use to compare
right.
The other groups. So the next one is BIPOC folks without a disability. That index is 93. It's almost three times higher. So if you're part of BIPOC communities, you're three times more likely to experience some kind of discrimination.
Sure.
Interesting. Well, it gets more interesting because below the line are the folks with disabilities, the white with disability and BIPOC with disability, and you can see that those numbers are quite a bit higher still. So what we're seeing here is that the impact of having a disability has more impact on your discrimination experiences than being part of a marginalized community, not having a disability. So it just shows that having a disability is more
profound.
Yeah, more profound, right? So one conclusion is that, hey, the One Minnesota promise needs to include people with disabilities.
Right, absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So the other things that we found, you notice that white with disability, that index is even higher than BIPOC with disability.
Now, why is that?
Yeah. We don't know for sure, but what mm-hmm. we think is that it's the loss of privilege impact.
Sure.
So when we did the qualitative work a year and a half ago, we surmised that discrimination happens in the absence of privilege. And so a person who grows up in a, let's say, a white community is used to a certain level of privilege.
Right.
When you have a disability or a child with a disability, you feel that there's a drop
right.
of privilege. So there's a lot of things that you no longer have privilege
wow.
or access to. So they feel it more.
Absolutely, it makes total sense.
Yeah.
Total sense.
Yeah, so then the other, the rest of the survey had other questions about how you feel, how you're treated mm-hmm. in a large range of different situations.
Okay.
And what we found from that is that although white with disability and BIPOC with disability, they experience a lot more incidences of discrimination, but there's some subtle differences
sure.
in where the different groups are experiencing less privileges or more barriers and so
right.
forth.
Well, let's move on to your next slide.
Oops.
There we go.
Yeah, this at the end of the questionnaire, we asked this question to kind of get a grade for the states. And the question reads, of all things considered, using this 9-point scale, how would you rate the state of Minnesota and its people as a whole, and how well we're living up to the One Minnesota core values of diversity, equity, and inclusion for all Minnesotans? And what we show here is on this scale, it goes from very poor to excellent. A 7 is a good, a 5 is fair. All the ratings from the four groups were a little bit south of good. The folks with disabilities had the lowest ratings. So this is another thing that we will track over time.
Absolutely. Right. Well, the information is just astounding. And I think we need to continue to dive into it and do a lot of work in that area, because we need to do a better job of how we're treating everyone in the state of Minnesota.
Absolutely.
We're near wrapping up on our time here. If people want more information to dive into this and read the entire research and so forth, where can they go to get this information?
Well, I'm glad you asked that, Joan, because here it is right here.
Okay, great.
They can go to mn.gov/mndcd/ or actually, if you just went to mngcdd, you'd get there.
Catch it right there on the website. Great.
Yep, well, mmgcdd.com.
Thanks, Tom, for coming in and kind of dissecting this report for us. And it's fascinating, good work.
Thank you.
And I don't necessarily like the information, the results, but it's we've got a lot of work to do here in the state of Minnesota for One Minnesota, don't we?
Well, I'll come back in 5 years.
There we go.
Hopefully we'll see some
improvement.
Great.
Well, thanks so much for coming in and sharing this good information with us.
Thanks for having me.
Great. We'll be right back after these messages. I'd like to start first by saying thank you, Tom Pearson, for coming in and sharing this wonderful survey results from the One Minnesota survey that the Governor's Council on Developmental Disabilities conducted in the last year. We learned a great deal about how people with disabilities continue to be discriminated against in our society. So we have a lot of work to do. And the Governor's initiative on One Minnesota, there's even more work that needs to be done on making sure everyone's included in that slogan of One Minnesota.
And my guest today was Madeleine Hammerlund, again, housing campaign organizer for Our Future Starts at Home. And she has a big project ahead of her, and with the House and the Senate starting up real soon. But I think the response will be phenomenal and overwhelming, just to use two words. And I think it's a big issue. So I think she'll do very, very well. She has a few hearings to get through, but they can be gotten through, and so I think she'll come out the winner. And we look forward to having her on again. Great guest. And thank you all at home for watching. On behalf of Joan Willshire and the entire team, thanks for watching. Bye for now.